starting off right. And we've been talking over the last couple weeks about how do we get this new year, or actually our lives, going in the right direction. That's really what we were talking about. And as we talked about setting goals, one of the things we learned was this, is how many people say, man, I set some goals and then life happened to me. Anybody ever feel that way? It's like, I thought that life was going to do this, and then all of a sudden life took a turn, and it was like, that was no good, right? I mean, how do we make plans based on that kind of stuff? And so we talked a little bit about the first message, which was so foundational, to say that in Proverbs it teaches us to trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not on our own understandings, but if we submit to him, that he will make our paths straight and make our paths clear, that we'll know what God wants. And we explain, how do we do that? How do we listen to God? Not only what to do, but how to do that. And so if you missed that, go back. Newbranch.net is our website. And you can go right there, and all the messages are listed on our website, so you can go back and listen to them. Or we do have CDs. Last week we talked about attitude. And we said, hey, attitude determines so many things. It's not the only thing, because, you know, hey, we said, no, we don't want somebody that's a surgeon to operate on us just because they have a positive attitude, right? They have to be qualified. But here's what we know. Attitude can make us or break us, right? It can bless us or curse us. And what we learned last week was a plan that God has to say, how do we remain with a good attitude in every situation that we have in life? That would be awesome to be able to have, right? And God showed us a way to do that. And so if you missed that, go back and listen to it. Today, though, we're going to talk about the thing that is so small, or might seem small, but has a huge effect on our whole life. In fact, this is what your life will be determined by this one thing, and it's your habits. Your daily habits will determine where your life goes. It's a fact of life. The direction of your feet, not your intentions, determines your destination every single time. In fact, I could tell you whether you were going to be a success or failure by looking at your daily agenda. That it's daily, not in a day. That a lot of people think, hey, it's small things that we do on a daily basis that accumulate over time, good and bad, right? And so I got a couple of examples for you. The first one is this. I've been working out, and so here's some pictures of me. No, I'm just playing. I wish. But it's true, right? I've been working out for 3 weeks, and I don't look like that yet. But anyway, how many people know who this guy is? Who is it? You guys, you need to repent knowing this guy. No, I'm just playing. No, I love The Rock. I follow him on Twitter and Instagram and all that. Very motivational guy, and one of the things, but he'll explain to you. He didn't get like this overnight. In fact, you can look at the pictures and the progress that he's made with his body and what he does. And he works out every day. In fact, I watch him on Instagram in different places that he's at and all over the world. But he works out, and that's why he's been able to do that. But it's daily, not in a day. If you go to the gym this week, you're not going to look like that. I remember my nephew, he's into bodybuilding, and he's gotten huge. You know, he's taller than me, and now they're bigger and all that kind of stuff. And he can certainly lift more than me. In fact, I think he's getting ready to get married, and his wife can lift more than me. But anyway, his future wife can lift more than me. She's in the gym every day, so I don't want to lift with him anymore because I'm like, I'm not going to go there. But anyway, what you learn is this. Somebody told him, he's like, I don't want to get as big as you, David. And he's like, you won't. Because why? Because you're never going to work out to that level unless you're doing it every day. You don't get there by accident, right? It comes in increments. I don't know if you see that in the end. This is what The Rock's going to turn into, probably Mount Everest eventually if he keeps working out. So anyway, all right. So the other one is this. Sometimes it can be negative. You start off as Little Debbie, and you end up as Big Deborah, right? I mean, if you eat Little Debbie every day, this is what happens to you. And I love Little Debbie, but, you know, hey, it is what it is. But just understand the progression. You don't get there overnight. It's not one Little Debbie that gets you there, right? I love zebra cakes, by the way. But it's not one that gets you there, right? But over time, you keep eating those boxes and boxes and boxes of those, and that's what happens, okay? They don't put that on the box, but anyway, that's what happens. But here's what I want to talk about. Most of us understand that habits, your routine, will determine your life. It's absolutely true. That your daily habits are what you're becoming. Your daily routine is what you're becoming. If you smoke every day, there's consequences, right? If you're exercising every day, there's consequences. If you save money, there's consequences. And I don't know about you, but as I look at the year, I started off going, man, there's so many things I need to change. Anybody doing that? There's so many things I like to change in my daily agenda that I went, man, I got a page of like 150 things to start applying that I went, let's just go to Krispy Kreme. I don't care no more, right? I mean, it's just overwhelming, right? I mean, maybe you saw that on Facebook. I did go to Krispy Kreme, and that's why, because it's like, this is just too overwhelming. I can't do all this stuff, right? 12 days into the new year. Why? Because it's too much. And then I came across a thing. It was in a business book, and they were talking about habits. And this guy was explaining how that some habits are what they call keystone habits. I don't know if you ever heard of those. But and you don't have to read this stuff, the same stuff I do. But what a keystone habit is this. They're linked to other habits in your life. That if you get this one in order, the rest of them will fall in line. Does that make sense? Like, in other words, I'll give you an example. One of the things that they found was this, and I'm not saying this always works. If you don't do this, doesn't mean you can't do it. But they said a lot of times people are going, I want to spend more time with my family. And they found if I had a family dinner on a regular basis, it seemed like it helped us have better relations. That when we had family dinner, then we did that. And I know with my son, it wasn't family dinner, but I remember when he was real little, we used to take walks together. And then at some point, we kind of shifted where it was like something didn't work out for us to be able to do it. And it was like we stopped spending time together for a long period of time. Or we'll play a video game together or something like that, and we spent a lot of time together. Some people say Xbox won't bring you together. It does for us. But then we didn't play the same games for a while, and then we kind of got away. And so it's like, man, how did that happen? Why didn't we spend time together? Because it's a keystone habit that kind of all these other things link. Some people say, hey, if I get my exercise routine right, I'll start eating better. Has anybody seen that? So they're kind of linked habits. And what I want to talk to you today about is this, is not to overwhelm you, because I was like, when I looked at this message, I went, I think I don't want to preach this because it would just be so overwhelming to say, how do you get all the habits in your life straight? And then it came to me as I looked at a passage of Scripture, and I said, no, we preached on this before. I don't know if we want to do this. But what I know is this, is that there is one habit that can change your life. There's one daily habit that's the most important habit to have. It is the most keystone to everything. If you get this right, it will order your life. Does that make sense? That sounds like a great habit to have, don't it? And I don't think it's going to be shocking what the habit is, but I think it's difficult in knowing how. So today we want to spend a little bit more time talking about how than that it's important. But here's what I know. If you get this right, it will order your life. It's guaranteed. Now, it doesn't mean your life will be perfect, okay? Nobody's saying that. But here's what I know. It will speak to every single area of your entire life. If you get this right, it will bless you. If you get this wrong, it will curse you. There is no possible way you can have a great life without this habit in it. And today I want to share with you what it is. Now, the problem with this is this. The passage of Scripture we're going to cover today, we've covered many times. And so for some of you, you're going to look at it and you're going to go, yeah, got it. Heard that before, why are you redoing it? But as I prayed in my quiet time, and as I looked at talking about habits, I had all kinds of things, and as God brought me to this passage of Scripture, I said, I'm just going to have to share it again. So what I want you to do is this. I want you to look at this passage as though it was your first time, okay? And look at it through the lens, not of other lenses that we've looked at this passage through, but look at it through the lens. Now, there's one application, there's one interpretation of the Word of God, many applications. Does that make sense? So we're not reinterpreting the Word of God, but we're just saying there's another application, and that is look at it through the lens of your daily agenda, and God's about to speak to it, okay? So that's what we're going to look at. If you've never heard this passage, listen to it like it's your first time. It'll be a lot easier for you. Just messing with you. All right, so Luke chapter 10. Nobody laughed at that. Wake up. All right. That was funny. It's okay. All right, Luke chapter 10, verse 38. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. Jesus had been traveling a lot during this in his ministry. He had started it, and he did miracles, so lots of people would crowd Jesus. And he was teaching so amazingly that he was kind of wore out from a crowd. So he went over here, and this family kind of opened their house to him. He had a good relationship with his family. Verse 39, she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. What I want you to underline today is this, sat at the Lord's feet listening. If you could underline that, very important. And I want to tell you, if you want to know what the whole message is about, the one habit is this one right here. It's not rocket science. Spending time with God. She spent time with Jesus. Whatever else was going on in her day, she set it aside, and she spent time with him. That is the one habit. And we'll come back to that because we're going to unpack that a little bit, okay? So verse 40, here's where the problem comes in. And this really is a but. So circle the word but. Okay? That means a dichotomy. She was doing this. There's what Mary was doing. But Martha. Okay? But Martha was distracted by all. Now, it doesn't mean that Martha didn't love Jesus as much as Mary did. But Martha had a problem. She had a lot of things going on. Right? So I want you to circle distracted by all. Because if there's one thing that keeps us from having a relationship with God or spending time with God, It's all the other things in our lives. So when I say, and I can tell even by the look on some of your faces, when I said the one habit that will order your life, you're thinking, yeah, right. Because life, if it's nothing, it's multifaceted, correct? I mean, I don't know about you, but I start with one agenda in the day, and it's like I didn't get to most of that because I kept getting interrupted. Anybody? And you're going, But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. Verse 40 continues to say this. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care? If you could circle that. Don't you care? Don't you care that my sister has left me here to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Let me tell you what he's not saying, and then let me tell you what he is saying. So Jesus is not about to teach a principle that's saying, if you're one that likes to have a good time like myself, and your wife is one that is more organized, and you look at them and you go, yeah, I'm kind of having fun right now, you do all the work. That's not cool, okay? My wife has explained that to me, and anyway, so I get the idea, okay? Not cool. By the way, it's not cool, okay? It's not cool for one person to do all the work and somebody else to get all the benefits. That's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is somebody that has set aside time to spend time with Jesus, and the other person was going to, but they realized, I got all of this stuff. I got all of these things. I got all of these priorities. Can I tell you something? When you got too many priorities, you know how many priorities you got? None. When you have too many priorities, it means you don't have any priorities. That's why I say the one thing. If you can't point out the one thing that's the top priority, you don't have priorities. What you have is a whole bunch of things that you do. And you think by tacking on more, you're going to do this. And what's not going to work about today's message is this. If you're just going to tack this on as one more thing, it won't work. So what is she doing? And this is a whole side note, a whole nother message for another time. But here's what Martha is doing. She's looking in there and she's going, I got all this stuff to do. The house has to be clean and the things, and Jesus show up unannounced, and I got to cook all this meal, and he needs all this stuff. And it's just like her life was just getting out of control, right? And so what does she do? Because she knows, well, I can't correct Jesus, right? Because he's God. So what does she do? She passive-aggressively says, don't you care that my sister has left me here to do all the work? It's a passive way of saying, why didn't she talk directly to Mary? Because Mary would have said, I'm spending time with Jesus. I'm not doing what you're saying, Martha. And I'm having fun, and you're not going to keep me from spending time with him right now. Because all that other stuff, that's your priorities. They're not mine. I got a feeling that's why she knew. And when we can't get somebody with the actual thing, then we get passive aggressive. And can I tell you something? If you got to say it passively aggressive, don't say it at all. But some of us, and you got to watch yourself, that's called a guilt message. And if you can't say it directly, don't say it at all. I'm telling you, that may go a long ways this year because I find myself doing it a lot, right? I don't want to say that, but here's what I do, right? I'm not saying but, right? Or yeah, that must be nice for you, right? And it throws a spoiler. It's like, I want that in my life. I don't know how you have it, so I have to vilify you because you're happy and I'm not. That's what it means. That's what this passage means. Doesn't mean we shouldn't help. Doesn't mean you shouldn't be direct. If Mary was doing something wrong, she needed to come up to Mary and say, Mary, you should be helping me. Not going behind, not talking to somebody else. You see what she's doing? She's gossiping to Jesus. And let me tell you something. When you don't have joy in your life and you have too many priorities and you're getting frantic, that's exactly what you're doing, and you're bringing in other people. So you're going, Jesus, I want you to tell her that I said, if you're doing that, it's wrong. And let me show you how Jesus responds. That's a whole side note. That's not the point of the message today, but for somebody, you might need it, okay? Verse 41, your spouse, right? Is that what you're thinking? Your spouse needed that day. Okay. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things. If you could underline worried and upset, many things. What makes us worried and upset is because we have so many things. We have so many habits. When we look at the new year and we go, I got to do this and I got to do this and I got to do this. And how could you say that I need to spend more time with God? I don't have it to give. And Jesus is calling her name. Martha, Martha, calm down, right? Can I say what God's doing today? Hey, slow down. No. This is not about throwing guilt. This is not about throwing guilt to Martha. What he's doing is he's pointing to what is going on in her life. Please don't misinterpret Jesus. He's not just comparing. What he's doing is one, he's saying there is a boundary for Mary and you're not going to violate it. But there's another part. He's trying to help Martha. He's getting to the root of the cause. He's going, hey, you're so frantic. You ever done that with somebody? They're getting so worked up and so amped up and you're like, just take a breath. Just slow down. You don't have to do all that, okay? Verse 42. But few things are needed, or indeed, only one. Few things are needed, but indeed, only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her. That's the boundary. But before that, he's helping her. See, you're busy, and a lot of people have taught this message, and I'm not saying they're wrong, but they're wrong. No, I'm just playing. No, a lot of people have taught this message, and what they've said to it is that they go, she's busy making all these preparations, and that's what Jesus was talking about. That's not untrue, but the one thing isn't one dish. The one thing is the one thing, spending time with Jesus. It's the same link that he says that if you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these other things will be added to you. You know, he said that around the same time period, by the way. You know why he said that? Because he said, if you get this right, the rest of your life will be ordered. So you mean to tell me if I spend time with God, the rest of my life will just fall in line? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If you listen to God and you're spending time with him, well, let me ask you. If you were to spend time with God every day, if God were to come and speak into your life every day about every issue of your life, do you think that might help you? The master of the universe, the one who knows the beginning from the end, that knows the day you will die, the day you were born, and why you exist, because he created you, do you think spending a little bit of time with him would help in your daily life? Oh, yeah. Well, how do you do that, right? I mean, that's really the question. The question isn't whether that is, right? So you can write it down if you want to. The most important habit, daily habit that there is spending time with God. That's what Jesus was saying, right? The one thing, only one thing is needed. What is he saying? Is he saying that life isn't multifaceted? Is he saying not to get around to stuff? Let me tell you something. Jesus accomplished more in his life in the 3.5 years of ministry than anyone else in the entire planet has accomplished in a lifetime. It's a fact. So don't think that he's an underachiever. That's not it. What he's saying is, have this as your priority. But here's the thing. It's a keystone habit. If you get this right, it will speak into every other area of your life. How many people think, if God could speak into my marriage, it would be better? If God could speak into my finances? If God could speak into my health? If God, and he wants to. And there is a simple plan in order to get it done. So I don't think I have to do a lot to explain how important this thing would be, but just so you know. Okay, so what is the problem? The problem is all the distractions, right? I don't think I really have to spend a lot of time there either, but you can write that down, is that all the other things in life, John, I would do that, but you have no idea what I face every day. It's absolutely true. But somehow, when something's important to us, we find a way to go, hey, hey, hey. And what Jesus is doing is he's going, hey, you're being distracted by all, right? Because it would be very easy to go, let's talk about daily habits and let's tack on a couple of them that might help you today. But if you miss this one, you're going to miss them all. But if you get this one right, you might not get everything right in your life, but it will make your life so much better. So here's the thing. Get your eyes off of all the distractions and get them onto Jesus, and let's see a simple plan in order to spend time with God every day. Now, it's easier said than done, right? Because here's what I know, and that's why I want to pause with this distraction thing. I don't want this message to be one where you go, man, I just feel so guilty right now. Right? Anybody do that? Where it's like, you know, I tried to read a Bible, and what happens is I always get interrupted. You know, I mean, some people have that, right? Or I try to do it, and I just can't get in the rhythm, you know? Or to be quite honest, if we were ever to be really honest, and I've never been able to be honest about it because it's like, you know, I grew up in a pastor's home and all that, and so you know, the Word of God is so awesome, and it is. And if you learn to read it, it's the most awesome thing in the world. But when you don't know how to read it, can we just have a moment of honesty just for a second? It can be the most confusing thing I've ever read in my entire life. I don't know if you have. But somebody says, you need to read the Bible. They don't tell you how, but you get into the Word of God, and you're like, I read Genesis, a little confusing. Exodus, a little bloody. Okay, Leviticus, I'm sorry, who wrote that, and what is it for, right? And it wasn't until I went to Bible college and somebody explained it to me that I went, Leviticus is awesome. I mean, maybe you don't think that because you don't understand it. But when you understand it, it's awesome. But I went, how can someone read the Bible? I didn't get nothing out of that, right? I mean, and half the time I'm falling asleep, and I don't know, I'm a good reader, and I don't do good reading. And so how do I do this? Can we just be honest for a second? And some of you guys are going, that's me, okay? If that's you, understand, you're in the same boat with most of us, okay? Can I tell you something? I talk to a lot of pastors, and they do a great job prepping for sermons. But you say, hey, how's your quiet time? Yeah, what? And it's kind of one of those, yeah, I spend a lot of good time. preparing. No, no, not preparing. You got to spend time with God. And as a pastor, if I'm not, then what happens is I can work very good at dispensing the word of God, but it never gets inside of me, right? Have you ever met a pastor that was so good, and you're like, every week they preach and preach and preach, and then later on you found out they had a moral failure? They had an affair, they were doing stuff on the side, and you're like, how could they deliver such a good, because they got very good at dispensing the word of God, but they stopped taking it in. Get it? That's why it's so important. It's important to me, it's important to you. And so what I want to do today is this, is I just want to share with you the plan that God gave to me. Hopefully it will help. If you have a plan, you don't have to use this one. So I'm not trying to say, hey, everybody has to do it the way I do, because not everybody's made like me. And you're going, yeah, that's right. Okay. And that's not a bad thing. But what I want to do today is this. I want to share with you a plan that somebody shared with me. It's not mine. What I found is I do a lot better when I go, hey, let me take somebody else's plan and kind of customize it to me. And I came across this plan, and I said this first service, I said 10 years, and I think it's been more like 15, 16 years, maybe 17 years. I heard this message by a pastor named by Wayne Cordera, and the reason why I wanted to listen to Wayne Cordera is he's a pastor in Hawaii, and I thought, man, wouldn't that be cool? He had the fastest growing church for a while, and it's in Hawaii, and he's doing all kinds of cool stuff there, and I went, that's what God wants me to do, right? So I started doing some of the stuff that Wayne recommended, this Bible plan. I'm like, that's awesome, because I want to be a pastor in Hawaii, and then I became a pastor, and I stopped this plan for a while, because here I am in Zuna, you know, I'm just fine. That's for you, Zen, yeah, okay. Yeah, Windsor. Close to Zuna, whatever. All right, so close to the edge of the earth. Okay, so, but you get the idea, right? But it's awesome. I love this place. But here's what I know. As I started doing this, and I've been doing this for years, it really changed my life. Now, I got to tell you, I got to remind you, it's daily, not in a day. So please don't think I'm going to do this one day and now I'm done. Give me the one shot, right? Let me sit down with Jesus one time, okay? If I brought the master of the universe in any other area, if I said, I'm going to bring the richest person here to explain finances to you, and you said, yeah, I'm going to meet with them one time, they're going to explain everything. No, they're not. But if they said, hey, I'm going to meet with you every day, oh, man, right? You're going to be a guitarist, and I brought in, I don't know what artist you guys like, but Eddie Van Halen came in. Everybody know who he is? Eddie Van Halen comes up and says, I'm going to teach you how to play guitar, but you got to meet with me 1 hour a day. And you're like, if you want to be a guitarist, you're not a guitarist. You're like, I want to meet you, sign my autograph, thank you, but I'm not learning because I don't care about guitar. But if you want to learn, you'd be like, I'll be there, right? I don't care what time it is. I'll make time for Eddie Van Halen showing up an hour a day, right? But imagine if the God of this universe that knows more than anyone else said, I will meet with you on your timetable. When can you meet? Every day, less than an hour, 20 minutes a day, and I'll feed into you. But see, the thing is, here's why we get discouraged. I want God to speak to me now, but that's not how it works. You see, many of us have misunderstood the word of God, the sword of the Spirit. When we talk about, and maybe some of you guys have heard about the armor of God, maybe you haven't, but there's a thing where they give an analogy and they say, hey, the word of God is like a sword. It's the sword of the Spirit. And what that word means is this. It's not the whole scripture. It's the word of God that comes to you at time of need. It's called the Rhema word of God. There's another word that means logos, which means the entirety of scripture. But the problem is this. We think that God is going to bring something back to our remembrance that we've never studied before. And can I tell you something? That's not true. God works with his word. His word. And what we're looking for is some sort of esoteric experience where God all of a sudden speaks to us as though he's talking to Moses, okay? And he does. He talks to us like Moses, but every day, daily, not in a day. So God is saying, hey, when the crisis comes and you haven't been in my word, I'm sorry, I don't have a lot. I'll help you. But there's a lot of things you don't know. Anybody done that where it's like, man, I'm in crisis and I didn't know what to do. I don't know what my path is. I don't know how to make my path clear. God hasn't been speaking to me because you haven't been listening. And today we're going to help you, not to make you feel guilty, but to say, how can I listen to God? What if he could do it in small increments so I'd be prepared? Imagine if God had a plan. It's kind of funny to say imagine. God has a plan for your life. And imagine if he could speak through his word right now to you every day, but you can't get it all at once. Does that make sense? It's not that God doesn't know. He knows everything. But he's saying, I can't give it all to you at once because you're not, your mind would explode, right? It's like saying, here's what I'll tell you. You try it. Read this Bible this week. Right? You're going, right? I don't want to know it that much, right? No, you read a little bit at a time, and God will speak to you a little bit at a time. And so I think there's a plan that could make it so simple for your life. So I'm going to give you just a couple of tools to bring, okay? Because when you work out and stuff, they tell you, hey, you know, I just joined Planet Fitness. They're like, you can't wear blue jeans, okay? You got to wear their attire, whatever. So we're going to give you the stuff, and we'll even help you with it. If you don't have these, you don't have funds for it, let me know. We'll help you with it, okay? Number one, write this down, tool. You need a Bible. If you're going to read the Bible, you got to have one, right? So if you don't have one, if you can't afford one, we have one here, okay? Or if you can't afford it and you just say, hey, I want to check this out and I don't want to pay for one right now, go to the Welcome Center, ask them. We got lots of Bibles. We'll be happy to give them out. If we don't have any in stock, just let us know. We'll get you one this week, okay? I promise you. We'll get you one this week. Now, I say Bible or Bible app, which is the same thing. Now, I'm talking to some people that sometimes don't like it. I have my Bible with me all the time. You might not know that. But there's a thing called the Bible app, most used version of the Bible that there is. It has all the versions right there. If you go to Google Play Store or Apple, you can download the Bible app. So don't fight technology, okay? And I'm not saying you have to use it. There's nothing different between this or this. Now, some people say, I need the real thing. Now, can I tell you something about the real thing? Just for a second, because I've heard this a lot, okay? That's good for that, but I really need the real Word of God, okay? Can I tell you something? And this might come as a shock. The Bible didn't come in English, okay? And the Bible didn't come in a printing press. So this ain't the real Word of God. I'm so sorry for you that you think this is how it came down. This is the real Word of God, but the technology changed. And by the way, when they made the printing press, the people that had the scroll said, I need the scroll, okay? And I don't see any of you guys pulling out the scrolls, okay? So all I'm saying is this. I'm not saying you need to embrace technology or not embrace technology. Just don't down technology, okay? Because it's the same thing. And some of you can use both. That's what I do, right? Whatever works for you. If you're in Zoom, I'm so sorry. I know you can't get anything out there app-wise, but it's okay. All right, but you get the idea. So Bible app, if you just type in Bible underneath the app store, it'll pop right up. And it'll read it to you. It will do all kinds of things for you, but you'll have the Bible with you all the time. Maybe you didn't know that. Just want to make sure you knew. Second, you need a pen. If you want to, we would love for you, take one of ours, okay? Wouldn't it be awesome if you're writing things about the Word of God with a New Branch Community Church pen? We would love that, okay? The other thing is take an extra one and leave it somewhere, okay? And by the way, just take it, because here's what I know. If you take pens, that's what these are for. So many people are like, I turned my pen back in. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to take your pen. These are for publicity, so please take them with you, okay? Every week I go around and I put pens back into things, and there's hardly none taken. Please take these pens. They are for getting in the community, so take them to work. Here's what I know. After a while, you'll put one down and lose it, right? That's what we want you to do, because that's going to show up wherever it's at. And we go in places, and right now, every place I go, they're like, hey, see my New Branch pen, you know? I go eat Chinese in Chesapeake. Everywhere I eat, there's New Branch pens, all right? So just do that for us. It's absolutely awesome. But one thing you need a pen. I forgot number two. Number two, you need a reading plan. If you don't have a plan, you've already planned to fail, okay? Because you won't know where to start. You'll be confused. If you read the Word of God a lot, you may not have to have as big a plan because it's a routine for you. That's great. If it's not a routine for you, it'll be confusing. Just like working out. Guys that work out all the time, you don't see them with a single piece of paper. Guys that haven't worked out in a long time, you need a piece of paper, okay? Because you don't know what to do, okay? And that's the same for the Word of God, and we're going to give you a simple reading plan that works for me, and hopefully it'll work for you if you don't have one, okay? So you need a reading plan, need a pen, and you need a notebook, okay? Just a plain notebook, $1, all right? If you need a notebook, let us know. I like the Star Wars ones, but anyway, that's a whole different issue. Does that count if you write your, okay, your quiet time in a Star Wars notebook? All right, so Bible, reading plan, pen, notebook. That's it. So you come with that, and then here is the simple plan. And we've shared it before, but we'll share it again, okay? Number one, Scripture. The simple plan for spending time with God every day, Scripture, the Bible itself. Not any other books, not anybody else's comments, but just start with the Bible. Read one chapter a day, okay? That's too much. You can scale it back a little bit. If you want to read more, maybe you can do more. But what I've learned, even as a pastor, I can't absorb more than that. That's just me. I don't know about you. I can read more than that, but have you ever done that where you read a lot, and then you come back and you go, what did I just read? I do that a lot. Where it's like you're reading and you're like, I don't know what, I mean, it made a lot of sense when I just read it, but now I forget. So one chapter a day, because that's enough to be able to get the idea. Number two, observe, okay? I told you this is going to be a simple plan. Observations. Number one, scripture. Number two, observations. What do I mean? If we could go back to the verse of scripture that I was using today, I'm telling you, most of the messages that I bring come from this type of stuff. All we do is, you know, maybe a couple weeks, maybe months, maybe years, I've read this before, and I'll circle things that God's saying to me, something that stands out about the passage. So when I look at this one, what stands out? You know, before that, I was circling words like, hey, distracted by all. And we come here, whenever I see something that says, the one thing you need to do, well, I'm circling that, right? God's telling me the one thing I need to do? The one thing that's important? You don't need all this stuff, you need this? That's the kind of stuff you want to pay attention to. So you just circle it, and that's all you're doing. You don't have to do anything. If you want to write them down, if you really want to be a high achiever, okay, there's a space on the page. Take the little things you underline and just say, hey, only one thing, distracted by all. Don't do this, do this. Makes it really easy. That's what you observe from the scripture. The third one is this, application. Now you take it and you look over the things you just observed. So you circled a bunch of words, and now you're saying, what does this mean to me? What is God saying to me from this? What in the passage we just read, if you were to look at that and you've read that today, you would say, you know that he's talking to other people, so you're not taking promises made to Israel for us and that kind of stuff. But you're not taking it out of context, but you're saying, why would you want me to read this? Why would you want this to be? Is it something you promised me? Is it something you're asking me to do? Is it something where maybe my life is so busy and I'm not spending time with you and now I need to? So the easy application for today, one sentence. I need to spend more time with God. I need to stop being distracted by everything else. And if there's one thing I do in my life today, it's going to be spend time with God. Does that make sense? And that's it. Just one sentence. And you know what you've done? Teachers can tell you this. You've now processed the Word of God three different ways. You've read it, you've observed it, you've applied it, and the last thing you're going to do with it is pray. Prayer. Number four, prayer. What's the prayer? God, help me to do that. God, I'm claiming this promise. God, you get the idea? That's all you're doing. One sentence. God, what am I going to do with this today? And you're making an action step. God, I see that I need to do this. God, I'm going to commit to spending some time with you. God, I need to repent because of whatever. God, I need to change this in my life. That's all you're doing. Now, after you do it, you'll be like me. That wasn't very complicated. You think that's going to be life-changing? Not in a day. Daily, not in a day. Does that make sense? So there might be days you look at it and go, And then throughout your week, what's going to happen is you're going to say, man, something just happened. I think I read that. Right here. God spoke into your life and you're flipping back. Imagine after a week of doing this and you look back on this and you go, Man, I God just spoke to me. Does that make sense? And so that's what you're going for. You're going, hey, imagine after a week, what would happen if you went, man, I got six or seven things that I just learned from God. God just spoke to me seven times this week. God just spoke to me 30 times this month. God just spoke to me 300 and some times this year. You think that might be life-changing? You think that might help your marriage? You see what I'm saying? This is the one thing. If you don't get anything else, if God can start to speak into your life, how much difference this could make. Now, what I want to do is this. Most of us say, yeah, I kind of know that. Yeah, I'd like to do that. But where I've went wrong in the past is this, is that we stop there, but the reading plan part is the hardest part, bar none. And so I think I've come up with a simple plan that will work for us, and we can actually encourage each other to do it, okay? And the reason I say that is because most of the time people leave there and go, man, that's awesome, but I don't know where to start. So let me help you with that, okay? You could start it this week, and it would be so simple. Now, if you've got a plan and you don't want to use it, fine, I understand. But if you don't, and you've never done it, and you go, yeah, well, I'll keep researching plans, don't do that. Go ahead and start. Use this one until you find one that's better, okay? But if you're not in the Word of God every day, stop fooling yourself. Stop fooling yourself that you're getting closer to God if you're not spending time with him. See what he's doing? He's doing it just like with Martha. Martha, Martha, you're missing out on sitting at the feet of Jesus every day and speaking into her life. Mary has chosen the better thing, and Martha is missing out, not because Martha isn't a follower of Christ. She opened her door to him, right? She was a follower, but she was missing out. You could be saved and be missing out on a relationship with God himself. All right, so let me give you a very simple plan of where to start, okay? So here's what I would suggest, a weekly plan that will work. Number one, Sunday. Go to church. Okay. Don't have to be this one, but if you're part of this one, come to this one. We think it's awesome. All right, so go to church, listen to the message, which we know is awesome. Okay, so go to church, listen to the message, and get an outline. Every week we print out an outline, and usually it has a scripture on it. Can I tell you something? Not usually. Every single time it has a scripture on it. Okay, because everything we preach isn't based on what John's point of view, John's experience, John's whatever, because trust me, you don't want to pattern your life after everything I've done. We want to pattern it after the Word of God. We illustrate it. We're happy to illustrate it from that. But we do not want to say, hey, it's us. And hopefully we can point out in our lives that we're getting closer to God, and so life is going better. That's good. That's not a bad thing. But so what are you doing? You're looking at the scripture that we had for the week. So this week, if you pull out your outline right there, you can look. And what does it say? Luke chapter 10, right? We didn't read all of it. We read some of it. So you take that chapter, and for the week, here's what we would do. We would say, hey, read three chapters before Luke chapter 10 and read Luke chapter 10. And read two chapters after. So to make this very simple, and it's actually in your outline, so you don't have to write any of this down. On Sunday, you go to church. You've already done that, so you've already started. Monday, you would sit down, and you'd flip back to Luke chapter 7. And you'd say, all right, now I'm going to get some context. So I'll read the whole chapter 7, and I do the same thing. I've read the scripture. That's the scripture, one chapter. I've made observations. So you go through while you're doing it, and you circle some things. You can read it first. You can circle it. You can use it on your phone and highlight it. Whatever works for you is fine. And then you make the observations. If you want to write those observations down, even better. And then you make an application. God, what are you saying to me from Luke chapter 7? What is it you want me to apply to my life from this passage? And then you say a prayer. God, I repent for this. God, I'm praying for that. You see how simple it is? And then what do? Tuesday, same thing. You do Luke chapter 8. Thursday, Luke chapter 10. I'm not trying to make it so simple, but you get the idea. Friday, Luke chapter 11. Saturday, Luke chapter 12. And then Sunday, you come back and evaluate. Okay? If you want to do it here at church because you go, I just don't have time and I can't get a moment to myself, then you come here to the church, bring your notebook with you, and as I'm making announcements that you're not listening to anyway, okay, you know, when I'm welcoming new people because you're not new anymore, you can flip that thing open and say, how did I do this week? And here's what I don't want you to do. Don't look down the list and go, ooh, I only did it two times, right? Oh, that's bad. I feel so guilty. I don't think I want to do this anymore, right? Let's just go to Krispy Kreme. You know, I mean, that's kind of what I'm thinking. I'm like, I don't want to do that, right? I mean, I want to win, right? I'm a winner. I like to win, you know, but I look down and I see two times, but here's how I want you to look at it. Not perfection, progress. So you've not read the Word of God your whole life, right? I mean, you're going, this thing never made sense to me. And for the first time, you've read two chapters of the Bible. Good for you, right? And you look at that and you go, man, God spoke to me twice this week. Maybe next week you can be three times. Maybe next week I could do it all six times. I don't know. I don't know what works for you, but you're working out your rhythm, right? Because you're not going to get it right all the time. But you go, I did do that. And then pick it back up and do it again the next week. See? And it will work. And then what you're going to have is you're going to have a guide. This is why the writing down is so important, because a lot of people say, yeah, I read it. I go, yeah, really? Why don't you repeat it to me? If I were to say right now, Psalms chapter 123, can you tell me what it says? No? Then you don't know it, do you? So what you want, are you writing it down, is because you can go back and you can say, Psalms 123, here's what God said to me, right? Imagine if you could do that. You own it, right? And you're able to go, hey, I need some encouragement, and you start flipping back through a week's worth of stuff. You start flipping back through 30 days worth of God speaking to you. Or you start to go, somewhere along the line, here's what's going to happen to you, just like it does to me. Somebody's going to say, hey, could you get up and talk about something? Yes, I can. I got it all right here. Let me tell you what God did in my life. Let me tell you, he's been working on me and working on me about this. And you go, where do these messages come from? Right here. This is it. You go, I don't even need you anymore. That's right. And you probably won't. You get the idea? Because you could do this for yourself if you only open it up and you did it small incremental steps, but you have to do it. You have to commit to doing it. If you want to commit to this one habit and starting, let me tell you something. Once you start, you ain't never going to want to quit. Now, there's one other thing that I like to tell you to apply to this, and that's this. Don't do this alone. That's the reason why I picked this kind of schedule, okay? So every week, and I mentioned it earlier, that we have small groups that meet. Can I tell you one of the things that they do in small groups? Wouldn't it be great if you said, man, what if I was reading the Word of God and a whole bunch of other people were reading the same stuff? Imagine if there was somebody that took the time to write out a lesson about this very stuff, the very verses that I'm reading. Well, let me tell you something. There is, and it's me. Okay. okay? And every week I send a lesson based on whatever we talked about this week to the group. And part of that group now could be, hey, man, we've been reading the six chapters around it, and we could talk about that. Imagine what that would be like. Imagine going to group and going, hey, I got other people. Hey, what did God say to you? Hey, I don't understand this. What is he saying here? You know what I'm saying? And people heart helping each other. Imagine what that would be like. I think it could be really powerful, right? I mean, imagine a church reading. What could God do with a church where everybody is reading his word? Imagine if we look back and we're going, man, we have read, in this year, we read over 300 chapters of the Bible. What do you think God could do with a church like that? What do you think God could do in your life? How empowering, how much better would your marriages be if you said, God has spoke to me about my marriage? In 300 chapters of Scripture, I think he's bound to speak about relationships a couple times, right? I think he's bound to speak about finances a couple times. I think he's bound to talk about how do I deal with a jerk at work a couple times, right? And then you read Elijah and he calls down fire and you're thinking, man, I could do that. No, I'm just playing. Sorry, say sorry. In context, okay? That's why you got a group to help pull you back in a little bit. You get the idea? And if you were to do this, imagine what your life would be like. But it is daily, not in a day. And the problem is this. If you don't see it overnight, a lot of times we'll quit. And so here's my challenge for you today. For 30 days. If you don't commit to this today, don't fool yourself. You won't commit to it tomorrow. You will not become anything tomorrow. You're not becoming today. I need to think about this. I need to plan for this. I need to do all this. But let me tell you something. Habits don't work like that. It's a behavioral issue, not a head thing. It's a simple plan to say, hey, adopt this one for a while. If you don't have a plan, use this one. If you find a better one, use that one. You don't have to continue to use mine. But for 30 days, commit to doing it. Here's what I know. If you committed to do this for 30 days, you'll never want to stop. If you do, I'll give you your money back. Or you can give me your pen back. I don't know, whatever. But the point is... The point is this, if you tried it, I have never experienced this in my life, I have never experienced this among people that I've talked to. If you get into the Word of God every day and it starts having an impact like that, I have never met the person that said, man, you really wasted my time. That is 15 minutes of my life I can't get back. Let me tell you something, there is nothing you could do that's more important. No amount of news that you watch is going to affect the world like this does. So if you don't get to the news, this is more important. If you don't get to anything else, this is more important than anything. And that's not me saying it. It's Jesus saying the one thing, right? The one thing you got to do. Martha, you're missing it because you're distracted by everything else. And nothing else can do what God can do for you. But he can't do it in a day. He does it daily, not in a day. And if we would adopt it, let me tell you something, God would come in and change our lives. Now, it requires a relationship with Jesus. So if you don't know him today, when we pray in just a minute, we'll ask you, invite him in, because none of this will make sense. But let me tell you something. As you're reading the Word of God, you'll want to know the God of this Word, believe me. Okay? So, but what better day than to say, you know what, I'm going to make a commitment. But before I do, I need a relationship with you, God. And my relationship has been messed up by sin, and it has separated me from God, and I need to ask that the God would forgive me and come into my life, and he will, and he'll change you, and then you can start this journey. For the rest of us as believers, we're going, I'm a follower of Jesus, but I don't have a clue what he's saying. Don't fool yourself. It's daily, not in a day. Don't fool yourself and call yourself a follower if you're not following. Does that make sense? And I'm not trying to throw the guilt. What I'm trying to do is the freedom that you will have. Let me tell you what I found since I've done it. I have never said once, man, I wish I could get that 15 minutes back. They have been the most powerful times of my entire life. And you will want to go back again and again and again. But here's what I know. You got to start. So for 30 days, would you do it? And then the other thing is this. Would you get some accountability? Because here's what I know. I'm working out right now. I'm working out with my son, and it's helped a lot. Because there are some days I go, I don't feel like doing that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't know if it's worth it. But he's coming in, he's going, Dad, we're all going to do it today, right? Yeah. Right? You know, and then some days I'm with him, you know. I'm tired. I don't feel like doing it. Oh, I don't like that. Come on, we're doing it, you know. And you need a buddy. Sign up for a community group. Sign up for the meeting next Sunday night, okay? You don't have to join, but come find out about it. Take another step towards God. If you're not, just understand that's where you're going to stay. But if you want freedom, I'm telling you, you spend time with God, you get some accountability, it will change your life. Ask me how I know.